everybody, and welcome to another exciting, hair-raising, fun-filled episode of Radiorama, where we work on radios and tube-powered electronics from the 1920s through about the 1960s. And today we have another clock radio. Seems like I do a ton of these guys on this channel, but this is a 1959 RCA Model 4, or C-4FE. It is a typical 5-tube set. It has a clockwork mechanism on it, and I'm guessing it's probably not a telechron movement, because otherwise it would have probably said that. It says Levermatic. I'm guessing because it has these giant goofy levers. Let's see what this does. This is the drowse alarm. Ah! You can reset the timer so it gives you a few more minutes to sleep. Very clever. Anyway, it says it's an RCA filteramic, and I'm not sure what could possibly be in here that's anything other than just a regular, boring, old, all-American 5. Now, I haven't tried it out. It looks like someone either had cats or a dog that chewed part of the wire, and they only got to about right there. So I'll have to lop that off and put a new plug on it. But let's go ahead and see if it does anything. And for those of you that are safety conscious minded, yes, correct. I should be running this through a variac to slowly bring it up. But I'm not going to do that. So anyway, let's first of all, let's see if the clock works, which it is. We've got the second hand movement going. I'm assuming this turns it on. About 60% of the time, these guys will hum. Okay, that's all we need to know. That the electrolytic capacitors are shot. This is pretty late for tube radios, so I'm assuming it's probably on a PCB board. The other thing I'm going to do is, I've noticed it's got kind of a nice pink front end. It's kind of like it's kind of got this dreary cream color back, and it just, I think this back end could be painted some other color, maybe a different shade of pink, and that way it would really bring out the, you know, the color of this thing. Otherwise it looks a little drab. Another thing is, you see these hands here? That light green stuff is actually paint that has a little bit of radium or tritium in it. Rule of thumb is, you don't want to ingest or inhale any of that stuff, and it looks like this is in pretty good condition. I'm probably going to touch it up with a little clear varnish just in case, just for the hell of it, to keep it all together. By this time, they weren't really using a whole lot of radioactive product in the paint. Earlier on, when they were putting a lot more of it, this would have turned brown because the radiation would have eaten the paint, but it hasn't done this here. One time we actually did hook up a Geiger counter, and you could only measure anything if you got like right on it. You know, even if you backed up like this much, it would register almost zero. So again, there's not a lot in there. It's fine. Don't freak out about it. It's kind of like asbestos. You should handle it, you know, with respect and understand it. But it's not necessarily the boogeyman. Looks like we have a phono input, which means there's probably a couple of spades in there that either connect or disconnect, and that disconnects the radio IF. We can probably tap into that with a switch instead of using that jack. And so let's take the back off and we'll see what's going on under the hood. Okay, so I got the chassis out, and when I took it apart, I heard a lot of rattling noises. This is a kind of plastic. It's real brittle. So whoever took it out of the case last must have broken a few things. This piece was broken off and loose. And so is this piece over here. So I used super glue and silicone glue to put it all back together again to make it more stable. Likewise, the plastic keeper for this guy was disintegrated for the ferrite magnet. It's back here. Just turns into like plastic bits. And indeed, this is more of a it's either a general time or a sessions movement. It's just a big spinning flywheel. I'm going to squirt some WD-40 down in there, and then I'll follow it up with some light machine oil along with oiling all this. I'm not going to try to take this off. Everything is just held on here with friction clips and stuff, and I'm just afraid this brittle as this plastic is, I'm going to do more damage. It's interesting that it has a little pilot light that goes to the emblem in the front. I'm guessing it must illuminate the clock dial, or maybe at least, I guess, the station area. Looks like we have a full complement of original tubes because they're all the same style print and everything. And here is our problem. This is the electrolytic capacitors. There are two here. 250 microfarad, rated at 150 volts DC. And it'll indicate which is which. Z is common negative. The other two, it doesn't matter, they're the same values. But what we need to do is I will need to remove this from the chassis. And what I do, in order for me not to lose my place about how this went into the board, is I mark it with a marker. That way, when you pull it out, if you lose reference where it went in, you can temporarily stick it back in and line up the mark so you can figure out what goes where. So I'm going to use my little solder sucking tool. I know it's a gross name. Solder sucking tool to remove this whole thing. And then we'll put two new electrolytics in there. All right, let me see if I can get in here without ruining the shot. So what I need to do is take my little solder sucking tool here. Piece of wire on the video screen. Hold on a minute. All right, that's better. All right, now let's try this. So each one of these little lugs here, and of course my soldering iron is not turned on. You can see how well prepared I am for this. Anyway, what you'll want to do is heat up each of your lugs and until you get the solder nice and molten. You just come in here, you pull it out. You see all the solder that just came pulling out of there? These little tabs are bent over. So I'm going to just pull the solder out from each one of these guys. I'm going to do that until I can start prying them up like this. Whoops. And then here's our last one. This is actually our common negative right here. And again, we'll bend this guy up a little bit. So now that I've pulled these tabs up, I'm going to clip each one of these and make sure that either you wear goggles or you aim away because you will shoot yourself in the face. Now, all we have to do is come in here and just get each one of these a little bit hot. There we go. Cap is now pulled out. No good. We can put new caps in this place. Well, it's time to test it out. I have these two teeny little electrolytics that replaced that great big thing that I pulled out of there. Yay, technology improvements. So, I find that about most of the time, maybe about 80% of the time, just replacing the electrolytics is all these things need just to get the bare basic minimum functionality. So let's go ahead and turn it back on, see if it's an improvement. Wow, that pilot light is actually more noticeable. I didn't notice that before. It's kind of nice looking.
Take a 1-0 lead.
Yay! I'm not even a baseball fan, but whatever. It's Labor Day. It's the local team.
Free home. The air smells sweeter.
And your voice sounds bigger.
Program, and I'm just...
Actually a pretty sensitive little radio. I guess it's because it's got this big-ass antenna here.
Station.
gotta say, I kind of dig that light. I bet when this is all cleaned up and everything, it'll look even better without having to go through all that dirt. That gives me the confidence to go ahead and clean up this guy, which is the back half of the clamshell, and give it a paint job. Because it is Labor Day, we're going to go off and do something, which is primarily go to the local microbrewery. So, hope that the rest of my fellow American compatriots that are watching are having a good Labor Day. And let us hope that in the future, things will be better. We'll get out of this god-awful fucking pandemic. Alright, so what I'm going to do is clean this up, use some good detergent and some rubbing alcohol to clean all the grease off, and then we'll give it a paint job. Welcome to day two of working on the RCA, and as you can see, we've done a drastic color change. I did this yesterday towards the end of the day. It's been pretty hot out here, so it's been sitting baking in the sun since yesterday, and I brought it back in. But let's go back over to the chassis, because what I need to do is finish the recapping job. We have 1, 2, 3 paper caps in there, and I would rather not pull the PCB board out of there because it's pretty brittle. And then what I'm going to do is do what I do on all of these sets, which sometimes is controversial to some people who are a little more purist than I am. I'm going to add an audio input, even though this actually came with one from the factory in a form of an RCA jack here. And if you're curious how the name RCA jack came into being, RCA, this company that made this set, invented that. So that's, they're still out there. It's part of their legacy, I guess. And it appears that we have 3 wires that go to this jack. We have a black wire, which I assume is probably the ground. We've got this cap that is attached to that ground, and that probably lowers the amount of current potential. What is that value? It's probably 0.05, or no, it's 0.082. That's quite high. You would get a little bit of a jolt if you were to touch ground and the outside of that, even though it's pretty hard to do, it's recessed, so at least they were trying to make it physically difficult. And look what I just did. I just broke that, so now I gotta reattach that. How annoying. But it looks like that the green and the yellow wire, what that does is the interrupter for the IF signal that goes to the volume pot. So I already know that I can add my switch for the audio input to turn the IF on and off so we can have clean audio when we port our audio through it. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's replace these 3 capacitors. As you can see, as I pointed out, the values are represented, printed on the sides. And I just use 630 volt DC rated caps generically, unless they say otherwise, which usually they don't. American sets, usually the values are anywhere from 150 to 450 volts. 630 is just good insurance, more than adequate. All right, so I've installed the remainder of the new capacitors, and I also cleaned up the tubes. And now what I'm going to do is add the audio input feature. And I'm just running a line in through the old RCA. And then that goes loop-de-loo through here, and that's going to attach to this, what I call an isolation transformer. Look at it this way. It's basically a wall wart. So on the primary side, which is these 2 pins that are the furthest separated, that is the 110 goes into, and then the go out to is the secondary, puts out 12 volts. So your incoming line is going in through the secondary, and that essentially will guard the user from potentially getting any kind of current through the end of this cord here, which is a 3.5 millimeter jack. Now, what I'll need to do is run a few more components on this before I make it final. So what you want to do is you want to put your right and left channels, they're either end of 200 ohm resistors. That can be another value. You can get away as low as 50. It doesn't really matter. Then you tie the ends together. That's your positive. Then your negative is going to be, in this case, just a black wire going to the other side of the other pin on the secondary winding. Now going from the primary to the incoming audio source, which is here, I believe, because we had a switch wire there. We want to make sure that this does not interfere with the set's AGC. And so what I do is I put a 0.02 rated cap. Doesn't have to be high voltage, only like 50 volts. And half the value of the volume control pot. So that'd be 270K. Put those together, and that'll prevent that from happening. And lastly, I'll have to install a switch. I've already got a like kind of a longish switch wire coming out. I make these oversized because I'm not sure where I'm going to run it, but I believe I'm just going to run it here because that would look nice. It'll go right next to the incoming line. So we'll do that, and then we'll give it a test run to make sure that both the radio and the audio incoming signal, it's doing the thing it's supposed to do. Okay, so now I've got my system installed here. We have our transformer with the positives actually going underneath the chassis. Attaches actually to the incoming RF side of the volume pot. And then the negative, of course, goes to negative. And I've got my switch wire here, which effectively means that the RF stage of the radio is disconnected. So I'll bring it up. I've got my little Bluetooth hockey puck running through. By the way, these are cheap. You can get these for about 15 bucks on Amazon or whatever. And so now here we have the audio coming in. Tears off the grid, I'm shedding for you. Though I know in my heart, no good would it do. Tears that are called. Of course, I've got a little radio leaking in, but it doesn't help that I've got this massive long cable, which is effectively acting partially like an antenna. But if I touch these two, we should get radio back. See? So all I have to do is dramatically shorten the length of that cable. And that means that when I do a final assembly, I can make that judgment. And in the meantime, even though it probably is unlikely this will ever shift around, I usually put a little glob of glue on this. So no possibility of anything touching that in the future. Now, the set is more or less completed. I'm going to plug this before I do this, but I've got some cosmetic work to do. I want to clean up some of this stuff here, and what I'm going to use is a toothbrush, just dampened with a little cleaner. And then I'm going to remove this and the knobs, and I'm just going to dab a little clear polyurethane on these indicators here, even though they look like they're in great shape. Then I'm going to polish the plastic. And then we can do a reassembly of the cabinet, install the switch. Hopefully it'll be done. All right, so I am in the first stages of cleaning this up. First of all, I've only seen this on one other set, but you might want to be aware of it. Is that most of these sets, I just assume that you just get a screwdriver and you push up on the tabs and the whole plastic panel comes off. This doesn't do that, because I started doing that and I noticed it wasn't giving, and I looked in the back and there's these little spring clips that hold it in place. Just be aware of that, because this plastic is super brittle. In the meantime, I put some satin varnish on the hands and I let that dry, and then I went after that and just used a dry brush to remove all the little dust bunnies that were in here. And now I'm going to plastic polish this with my favorite product, Novus number 2. I find that Novus number 2 works for everything, but the number 3 is like water. The number 1 I think is if you've got something that's royally scratched up. And none of my sets are usually that bad. If they are, there's not much that can be done about it. So we'll polish this up, put it back on there, because I don't want to splatter this. This is paper. I don't want to splatter that with the toothbrush when I get ready to clean all this stuff up. And then we'll do final assembly, and hopefully I won't break anything doing it, because again, this set is so freaking brittle, the plastic. I don't know. I guess they haven't quite figured it out yet at that point. All right, well, that's looking a lot better, and now it's time, after I've got all this plastic and stuff back on there, to clean the rest of this. What I'm going to use is a little warm water, some Simple Green, and one of my old toothbrushes. So if you do this kind of stuff, use toothbrushes. They're quite handy. I just advise that you don't use some from the garbage, from someone else's garbage. So all I do is I just get this like a little bit wet and just go in and just very gently scrub all the little fins, and that'll loosen up all the gunk. A lot of these guys wound up living in kitchens, so a lot of times some of this greasy stuff can actually be like 50 years of eggs and bacon being cooked on the stove. Anyway, I'm doing this one-handed, which is kind of impractical, but you get the idea. You just do this repeatedly, and then I'll go over it with a cloth to wipe it down, get all the dirt off. If you keep on using a clean water, sometimes it'll just happen. You'll have to do a lot of wiping down anyway. All right, so wood is now all nice and back together again. Even got my little drowse alarm button put back in there. And now that this is all cleaned up, this just looks pretty snazzy. I bet at night that's pretty nice to look at. And it's on, and I've got my Bluetooth adapter running through it, and I've got the switch turned to down, which means turn off the RF stage. And if I wanted to listen to the radio, disconnect that, turn the switch up. We got radio.
And the Odyssey app.
Don't worry about refinancing.
69 points. The S&P down by 15. The NASDAQ, though.
Onward bite to it. Wife has a hard time.
All right, so it works well. So the last thing I'm going to do is let it run for a few hours, just to make sure that anything that might fail due to the heat from inside the chassis, I want to know before I send it out in the wild again. I'm also going to make sure that clock actually keeps good time, but it seems like it's running real smoothly. So I'm going to set it to match my watch, and I'll come back in an hour or two and see if it's still keeping good time. And also make sure that, again, the electronics is still working. Anyhow, this was kind of a neat challenge. I think that making this cocktail pink really brings out the pink of the front. And yes, I am fully sure that some person's going to like this. Someone who doesn't mind pink. It's not my favorite color, but it seems like they sell for whatever reason. Anyway, thanks so much for watching. And as always, if you have any questions or comments, you can leave them in the comments section down below. If you like what you see, you can press that like button, and for the two guys that always mark it down, go ahead and mark it down. I don't care. Anyway, invite your family, your friends, your dogs and cat, even your goldfish, and they can watch the show. And until the next time that piece of vintage electronic device comes across my workbench, I'll see you guys next time.